I'll be calling on the third speaker of the first session, Mr. Suranjan Shom. Mr. Shom leads the financial services vertical for Hitachi Consulting based out of London, applying innovation, industry expertise, and engineering to address some of the biggest challenges in the financial services world today. From FinTech to RegTech, he is working with some of the largest names in the financial services space like Citibank, UBS, Credit Suisse, MUFG, and Rabobank for Hitachi Consulting, looking at a wide range of solutions from big data, blockchain, IoT, and artificial intelligence to solve implementation challenges around GDPR, PSD2, open banking APIs, RPA, robo-advisory, and distributed ledgers. His topic for the day is holistic trade surveillance in global banks using data science.
Good morning. So I'm literally on a bit of a whirlwind tour, so suffering from a little bit of jet lag because I was in Pune last night, straight from London into Pune, and then landed in Kolkata middle of last night, and then. So hopefully, I won't fall asleep while talking, so definitely it should be all right. While things get set up, let's do a quick check. I mean, how many of you are actually dealing with banks or financial services companies? Oh, brilliant. Okay. How many of you are actually working in banks? Wow. Very nice. We're doing some safety precautions here so that this laptop just doesn't slide off the podium. Yes, I will explain my subject topic. And as I was coming here, I kind of changed the subject a little bit. And holistic surveillance is just now one part of the overall topic. So the overall topic that I'm dealing with is basically detecting and preventing financial crime within the banking industry, within the insurance industry, et cetera, using data science. And there are various types of financial crime that can happen within a banking scenario. There is market abuse, of which trade surveillance is a way of dealing with market abuse. So when you hear about massive multi-billion dollar scams that has happened at UBS or that has happened at Societe Generale, involving insider trading, involving things that the bankers should not be doing, but they do it just because it's a very fine line, because most of the traders, their primary job is to make money for the bank. But in the process of making money for the bank, they just forget what is right and what is wrong, and they just cross the line, and they do various things that cause a lot of pain to the wider financial community and even the global economy. So one of those areas is market abuse, but market abuse is only just one element of, brilliant, it's all working. Excellent. So market abuse is just one element of financial crime. There are a few other types. So I've only got about 15, 20 minutes, so I'm not going to discuss all the different types of financial crime. When we go through our presentation, you'll see that I have a lot of content around specifically some of the algorithms that we can use, and I've got into details of those algorithms as well. I think they're probably better dealt with offline because we won't have time to go and get in the detail of every model that we can potentially talk about. Just a little bit about me. So I think the MC has already introduced me, so I won't go into any detail. Primarily started off my career with PricewaterhouseCoopers. I consider myself a global Bengali because I was born in London. I grew up in Kolkata. I started off my career with PricewaterhouseCoopers, spent some time in the US, and then settled in London for the last 20 years, working with a company called IM Group, which got taken over by Hitachi, so with Hitachi for the last 20 years from that perspective. And doing quite a bit beyond the consulting community as well, but that's a different forum of discussion. Okay. So if we look at what's going on in the financial services industry, there's a lot of regulation, and especially those from the banking community know that there's a lot of regulation. There's valid reasons for regulation because the banks are holding on to people's money, and they're not allowed to do just about anything they want with people's money, because last time we've seen in 2007, 2008, when the banks went overboard with people's money, it actually brought major global economies down, and that had a massive, the impact of that, I think we're still kind of facing for the last 10 to 12 years. So we want to get into a scenario where that doesn't happen, and in order for that not to happen, there's a number of different regulations that are put in place. Now, I won't go into the details of the regulations today. What I said is the topic of my conversation today, of the presentation today, is about different types of financial crime. And the three that I'll deal with this morning is around market abuse, a little bit around that, around money laundering, and then finally something which is more closer to home, so that we can all relate to it, is around fraud. Specifically credit card fraud and card fraud. So market abuse. Now, I just told you a little bit about market abuse. Now, market abuse happens in a scenario where, if you think of some of these larger banks, including HSBC, including Citibank, including UBS, probably about 60-70% of the revenue that these banks make are from investment banking operations, from trading operations. The retail operations are relatively smaller. I know the individual from HSBC might actually disagree with me, because I don't know how things have changed at HSBC, but if we look at most of the large banks, that's where all the money is. And therefore, the individuals who are dealing with this kind of money, it's very important to keep a check on what they're doing, how they're doing it. If we look at some of the major scandals that have happened in the last 5 to 6 years around the LIBOR rate fixing, FX rate fixing, these are all scandals in this particular area. And the way banks normally deal with this, two ways of dealing with it. One is on the basis of data. These are traders who are working within the banks. There's a lot of data being generated in terms of what trades they execute, what market data came in, the values that happened with the trade, et cetera, et cetera. That's pure data which you can analyze. But there's a lot that's going on which is not pure data. And this is mostly around the communication, the electronic communication information. So every person the trader called, every instant message that the trader was on, whether the trader was actually on social media during or before and after the time of trading. All of this needs to be taken into account when you're looking at irrelevant and anomalous trading activities and trading behavior. So banks who are now trying to put in place this kind of holistic surveillance mechanism are basically trying to look at a data infrastructure that kind of brings together structured data, unstructured data from both internal and external sources. And again, there's a massive list of different places from which you can get this data, from court transactions, from behavioral information, from information about the entities with whom you're doing the trade. So information about the customer, information about your counterparty, all that information. Unstructured data in terms of, as I said, in terms of voice communication, in terms of mobile communication, in terms of social media communication, bringing all of that in, and then putting it into a data repository, a data lake, applying analytics, applying machine learning, either rule-based machine learning or deep learning processes, to actually analyze an information and find out whether there's actually something wrong going on. And the use of machine learning obviously has gone more and more sophisticated in the last few years. The number of false positives that are being generated are reducing over time with better use of machine learning and with better accurate results coming out of the system. And the whole point here is, again, this is a massive operation for most of these banks. Bringing all this information together is not simplistic. When we're talking of voice data, when we're talking of text data, it's about algorithms which are trying to analyze voice information and based on that voice information, trying to figure out which counterparty is this trader actually talking about? What kind of trades are they talking about? Are they talking in a codified language? And things like that. It's analyzing all that information, layering that information on top of actual structured data. Because actual structured data is there, the trade data is there, the market data is there. Bringing all of that together and then generating enough alerts for the internal regulators within the banks to ensure that nothing wrong is going on. So that's about market abuse. Again, I could spend 3 or 4 hours kind of talking about how banks are doing market abuse and what can be done. Again, those who are from consultancies, there's a massive opportunity out there because no bank has actually got it right as yet. It's a massive problem in terms of there's too many systems, too many processes, too many data flows, too many algorithms to be put in place to actually make this work. So if there are people in consulting out there, there's a massive opportunity. There's a massive multi-billion dollar opportunity out there to actually get this right with most of the banks. So that's around market abuse. The next thing I wanted to talk about was around money laundering. Now, again, money laundering is another kind of major element of financial crime. Billions of, or rather trillions of dollars actually kind of going around. It's probably been identified as the second largest unofficial business in the world in terms of the amount of money that's actually kind of moving around the shadow circles. And the way money laundering happens is, first of all, the money comes in from an illegal source. It could be from drugs, it could be from terrorism, it could be from lots of other activities. That dirty money comes in, it gets placed into the bank. Then it's layered across number of different transactions. You got like different funds being created out of it, different structured products being created out of it. And then after that process of layering, that money is finally integrated back into the system through purchase of assets, purchase of other structured products. And once that money has gone in, it's like, you know, as all of you are very familiar with the term, kind of, you know, all the Safed money has become the Kaladhan. So it's kind of that process, but this is happening at a worldwide level and you know, at a scale which we can't even comprehend. I mean, I know there's a lot going on right now around demonetization, around catching people having black money, et cetera, et cetera. But this is at a completely different scale altogether, happening globally. And again, banks and other organizations and regulators are trying to kind of, you know, unearth places where all of this is going on. So obviously, AML today, or rather ML, machine learning today, can actually play a big role in uncovering some of the anti-money laundering activities that are going on. Various ways in which we can do this, whether it's based on clustering, whether it's based on rule-based principles around classification and prediction, whether it's around, either using multi-layered logistic regression networks such as neural networks or support vector machines, or potentially, again, we're looking at new ways of doing this using social networks and other hybrid methods, which, again, I can go into the detail of those a little more. There's a very nice paper which has been written by Ahmed Salehi Mehdi and Mohammed from University of Tehran on data mining techniques for anti-money laundering. Again, this looks at kind of the data infrastructure of how you can put all this information together and apply the algorithms. Couple of minutes, yeah, okay. So again, don't want to get into the details of that. There is a lot of information available out there. Can have a more offline discussion with you, more information around specifically what kind of models could be used for anti-money laundering. Again, I'll just show you this and then maybe we can have a chat later on. And I think the third one, which I just wanted to quickly cover, was around card fraud. Again, me being from Hitachi, we actually own a cards business ourselves as Hitachi Cards. We own a payments business called Hitachi Payments. And across this, there's, globally, there's about $190 billion of card fraud that happens all over the world. So detecting card fraud across the various elements of where that information comes in from, where the person is located, what kind of card is being used, what time it's being used, what's the behavior of the individual, what's the account profile of that individual, the purchase behavior, et cetera. Currently, there's, again, all of this happening in silos with proper data systems, with data lakes, and with big data and machine learning together. We can actually build that data intelligence that allows us to put all of that information together. So, you know, whether we're looking at, creating a digital identity of the individual, creating a customer, a profile of the customer, a profile of the transaction, we can bring all of that together to identify these in a much more and a quicker way. The last slide I just wanted to leave you with is, obviously it gives me a lot of pride to actually come here in the Bishwa Bangla Convention Center and be speaking here. And I would like to kind of recognize the fact, and I'm pretty sure you all recognize that as well, that Bengal today is a powerhouse of data science and a powerhouse of talent, with universities such as, you know, first top grade universities such as IIT, IIT Kharagpur, Jadavpur University, Bengal Engineering College, and of course ISI, we are probably very well placed to actually become the data science power hub of the world. So it's up to all of us to actually kind of bring our collective forces together. People like ourselves who are actually outside the country can help the country kind of, make Bengal visible on the world map for data science. So again, if you're interested in that, do have a conversation with me and let's see what we can do together. So once again, thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you, Gautam, also for this opportunity. And thank you everyone for being such a great audience.
Yeah, I'd like to call on Mr. Shankar Mukherjee to hand over the felicitation.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
And I'd like to tell you to stand back a bit. The thing is, if you have a couple of questions, you can always ask him right now.
If there are questions relating to the data mining algorithms, we'd rather do it outside. It's much better. But okay. Yeah, anything else?
Oh, there's somebody there with a question there.
Blockchain play a role. I could see your chart talking about ML on the algorithms and IT technology. How does blockchain play a role? Does it work in conjunction or is going to be something separate which is going to come up?
Yeah, so blockchain is a completely complementary technology to all of this. So where blockchain comes to play is when we're looking at, traditionally people have looked at centralized databases. So the databases are either sitting with the bank, they're sitting with the clearinghouse, they're sitting with the regulator, etc. With blockchain, obviously your database gets democratized. So you have a copy of that data through every node that's actually participated in that blockchain. So automatically, and because of the features of blockchain, because of the encryption, because of the inimmutability of the record, etc., what happens is you have inherent trust in the data that's being stored. Now, so all of this can quite nicely complement, all of these techniques can quite nicely complement blockchain, and in scenarios where it is essential to maintain that trust in the lineage of data, there blockchain will become very, very important. So for instance, a scenario such as trade finance, where there are multiple counterparties which are involved in a trade financing scenario, blockchain can play a massive role where every participant of that blockchain becomes a node and everyone has a true copy of that data. No one can actually kind of, do anything which is corrupt in that process. Now, having said that, blockchain is still, I would say, it's an early technology in an early stage. It's in terms of true SLAs, in terms of true performance, it's not yet quite there to be a realistic technology to do high volume transactions and things like that. There are optimizations happening within the blockchain space, because blockchain, the problem with blockchain is as you keep on adding more participants, your blockchain is becoming more and more difficult to compute, and you're actually burning up more compute cycles to store your data. So going forward, we're looking at more consensus-based models where we're saying it's not like infinite number of participants in the blockchain. Let's say we say there's 30 participants in the blockchain. So at least you've now solved the performance problem for that perspective. So it's still a few years away, I would say, but blockchain obviously has quite a good potential as a complementary technology to all of this.
Hey, good morning. So my question is, hi.
Oh, hi.
So my question is that Bitcoin is also being getting trapped by by the money laundering system, or because now we have heard that Bitcoin is getting a hype, some topic or Bitcoin transition is going on. So is there this money laundering system is getting trapped by this thing, or the Bitcoin system?
When you say it's getting trapped,
means
is there getting tracked?
Tracked.
Okay. Yeah. So right now, again, Bitcoin again is one of probably about a few thousand cryptocurrencies which are out there. Again, using blockchain as one of the key enabling technologies to kind of make that currency, those currencies available. Now, within the cryptocurrency space, there are a number of cryptocurrencies which are coming up with models which will actually not allow you to track. So, again, for various reasons, if you look at kind of the dark web, if you look at kind of people who are trying to hide away from all of this, from AML, they're actually now trying to use technologies that will actually not allow you to track the use. I mean, on the one hand, you have technologies such as XRP, technologies such as a few other places, Stellar, et cetera, which are getting to a scenario where they're actually joining hands with the banks and making they're highlighting the good points of cryptocurrency where you can do the transactions immediately, you can do the transactions kind of in a completely digital way, but still within the remit of the banking system. Whereas there are another set of cryptocurrencies out there which are trying to get away from the banking system completely, which again has its plus and minus points. So it's a space to watch. I wouldn't say one is getting tracked one way or the other. So by having blockchain out there, you're in no better situation right now to catch money launderers compared to what you are using 500 rupee notes at this point of time. Again, it's a space to watch and see what goes on. There's a lot of regulators worldwide trying to get handle on that.
Yeah. Thank you.